Father in heaven, we pray now for your Holy Spirit. We ask for your guidance and we pray for open hearts that as we take a look at your scriptures, that we will find personal relevance and application there. Father, you wrote things in scripture not just for words, but that we can find hope, particularly in times when we are in our valleys. But also, Lord, when we achieve victory and we are on our mountaintops, that we can remember that you are always there. And in spite of who we are and in spite of all that we do that against you, you still loved us. So much so that you gave your son for us and that you continue to accept us as we struggle on this planet. Lord, out of love, you've taken us as your own and you've called us your own. So Lord, to this end now, we pray now for guidance and understanding as we break open your word in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so as you can see, we have been talking in a series that we started 3 weeks ago, Bible Text for the Last Days. And over the last 2 weeks, we've taken a look at five texts every week, pulling together 15 key Bible texts that I would like for you to mark up in your Bible, put inside the liner notes of your Bible for the darkest hours. Now, over the last several weeks, in part one, we took a look at Deuteronomy 31, verse 8. And we're not going to take time this morning to read through each of these. You can actually go back and review the videos. But I wanted to put these down for those who are joining us for the very first time. That way you can, if you don't have time to look at the video today, you can at least write down these texts very quickly and then go back today, this afternoon, between lunchtime and Revelation Seminar and the end of Sabbath, and you can read these texts and you can mark them up in your Bible and try to find and meditate on each of these texts, the personal application in your life. Okay, so in week one, we took a look at these first five key texts spread throughout all of the Bible. Now, one of the things I said over the last 2 weeks is this is in a way connected to my Encounters with Jesus series, because I always like to end off with a text from John. So the reason I like John is because John presents Jesus through the lens of Jesus being God. And now we often think of Jesus as being familiar with our struggles, you know, as we take a look at Matthew. Matthew presents Jesus through the lens of Jesus as a king, which many of us can't relate to, you know, because we don't think of ourselves as kings or queens or princes or princesses. We just see ourselves as common people that have to work just to survive, right? And yet we learn something about God and Jesus as a king there. But when we take a look at, for example, Mark, who introduces Jesus as a servant, again, some of us can relate to that because a lot of us know how to serve, but even so, it's hard for us to grapple with the concept of Jesus being a servant because Jesus is God, right? Then we look at Luke as Jesus as a man, and there we can kind of see a lot of relationship that Jesus has with us because he identifies with our infirmities, he knows kind of what we're going through. And because he's king and he's servant, we can kind of bring that together. But all of that, even though we learn a lot, it doesn't really have full completion until we look at John. And John really presents Jesus as God. And the reason I like to look at these 15 Bible texts for the darkest hours and end it with John is because some of the greatest messages of hope actually come from Jesus' own mouth, giving it to you and I through the lens of him being God. So that's as if God was speaking to you directly, as if Jesus can come to your bedroom tonight, or if you were hiking and all of a sudden you had a vision like Saul had on the road to Damascus, and Jesus were to say something to you, it would be most likely these words that would be coming out of the book of John. And so in part one, I ended off with John 14:27. Last week, I ended off our next five verses through John chapter 16, verse 33. And so today, what I like to do is take a look at the last five verses. Now, there are clearly hundreds of great verses, and there's I had to pick and choose which ones I really wanted to bring out. But these are the ones that seem to get us through the dark hours. Now, if you wonder, well, what does Pastor Anderson know anything about dark hours? Trust me, I know dark hours. I've seen devastation. I've seen death right before my very eyes. I've lost family members. I've gotten sick. There's times when I could have passed away and I was on my deathbed. I've seen economic ruin and disaster during the Great Recession of 2008. You know, it's just, we have all gone through this together. And yet these texts have seemed to carry me through and has carried a lot of the patriarchs and prophets of many great Bible believers and God's people through time. And so it's especially relevant for you and I today. And why? Because I believe that the generation that we have right now could be the last generation on the planet. As you take a look at the signs of the times that Jesus spoke about in Matthew chapter 24, if you look at Daniel and Revelation, you see all of the fulfillment of prophecy getting closer and closer to the time when it feels as if all of the signs are coming very quickly now. And it's on a global scale. It's not just to one country. So, and more importantly than that, we see the gospel being preached throughout all of the world. So there's no way of quantifying how many people have heard and accepted the name of Jesus, which means that the hour of his coming could be any time now. So for you and I, we don't know the day or the hour. We don't even know the year, but we know when the season is near. And let me tell you something, the season is near. And so if it's true that we are that generation that will be blessed to see Jesus come, then you're going to need some messages of hope that will take you through some pretty perilous times that are still yet to come. Now, before I launch this, I was kind of getting ready and meditating for my message this morning, and I got to thinking about things that we're so used to as humans. And I want to have a little conversation with you as you're in the privacy of your computer or your living room watching this right now. You know, we've not seen miracles. We don't know what supernatural looks like. You know, we're used to tangible. We're used to seeing things that we can control. We see injustice and we go out and we protest. We see a wrong being done and we stand up for our rights. And yet where God operates is so beyond this concept. When Jesus comes, are we really going to be ready for that supernatural event where the sky rips open, the sun turns dark, the moon turns blood red, and the stars are falling down, there's a great earthquake? You know, if you actually think about that in reality and you're going through that, that's going to be a frightening experience even for God's people if you weren't expecting it. So here's the thing. I think from this point on, this pandemic has taught us all, expect anything. Especially expect the intervention of God. And if we're going to see the intervention of God, God's people have to be ready to see miracles. God's people has to be ready to see things that they've never seen before and not be frightened by it. And this is why it's important that right now we go to Scripture and we start to take in these messages of hope, because what I'm preparing you for are some things that are going to happen that's going to make you cause a lot of concern. You're going to be worried about what the future is going to hold. And I can tell you right now that many people are experiencing that right now. Even in this national election that's coming in November, no one knows what's going to happen. I've heard rumors that if Donald Trump is elected, that there will be massive riots and protests and anarchy that will take to the streets. I don't know if that's going to happen, but that's a possibility. I also heard that if Joe Biden is elected, that there will be a complete shutdown in the economy and the whole global world is going to collapse. And I mean, I'm hearing every horror story. Now, I don't know if that's going to happen, but I do know this. God is still in control. And if God is still in control, some things still have to happen. Number one, there's a lot of prophecies in Revelation and Daniel that have not yet been fulfilled. So God's people, you have to just sit tight, be patient, keep your hands on the plow, and don't get distracted by all of the news and all the conspiracies that you see on social media and in the news. You have to rise above all of this. Rise above all of the national elections and all the Republican and the Democratic stuff and the global economies and everything that's happening. And you belong to a different kingdom. You are a citizen of God's kingdom, and God is asking you to see things now through his eyes. He's saying there are going to be dark hours, but you're only going to see it with your eyes. You have to have faith that God's going to come through for you in a miraculous way. And if you ask something in his name, you have to actually believe like it's going to happen and not doubt and have skepticism. Okay? So I'm talking to you one-on-one, okay, in the privacy of your home, to get your mind to expand beyond what you can feel in the tangible stuff and be prepared for the impossible. You're going to see things with your eyes that are going to blow your mind away, because we know that we're going to see some great things happen according to prophecy. But that means that God's people have to equal and be equal to that. In other words, you have to have the faith that can match the tribulation that's going to come. If you're weak in that, you're not going to survive it. Okay, and this is a concern. So build your faith in the small things. Test yourself in the small things, so that way when that image is set up, you will not bow. That you can stand for God in the darkest hours and know that God has your back. Know that no matter what happens to you, you will still prevail. You could get COVID-19. Is that going to stop you? Even more so now. Do we have to proclaim the gospel? Because we know that we are not immune. We are not immune to the things that are happening in the world. Therefore, keep your focus on God and rise above it. And know that you might experience some of the trials, but God will sustain you and get you through it. Okay, now let's go on. Let's take a look at the next text. Okay, so this is text number 11, Psalm 139, verse 12. Now, David is writing, and notice what he says here. Even the darkness will not be dark to you. Now, last night I was walking from my bedroom over to the kitchen because I was very thirsty. I was coughing and everything, and I didn't turn on any lights. And here's the thing about that. I didn't stub my toe. I didn't run into any furniture. I didn't like hurt myself in the darkness because I knew how to navigate in a dark room in my house, okay? Likewise, if you know how to navigate in the dark times coming, and God already told you things that will happen before they happen, so that way when they do happen, you will believe. And you will know how to navigate through that without stumbling and falling and being fearful. Now, it was pitch dark last night. I was walking through and I was not afraid. And here the Bible says, even in the darkness, it will not be dark to you because you have a different kind of sight. The night will shine like the day. In other words, when everyone is in darkness and everyone can't, they don't know where to get hope, you in that darkness can find the hope, because in that darkness you see that God is still in control. Now, if you can't see that God is in control, this is why you need these texts. Okay? It says, for darkness is as light to you. This is what it means. When you see the darkness around you, you should be praising the Lord. And here's the reason why. Because God already told you there was going to be tribulation and persecution and darkness. And when you see it actually come, you know that there's a message of hope beyond the darkness. You know that at the end of that dark tunnel, there's the second coming. Now, if you're seeing darkness now, that only tells you that the second coming is closer now. So guess what? Bring it on. If this is what it takes to bring Jesus and end it all, and we get to see Jesus come, then bring on more of the pandemic, bring on the wars, bring on the famines, bring on the pestilence, bring on the starvation, because at the end of that dark tunnel is hope, and darkness will be light to you. Amen? So I want you to think about this, because when it's the opposite of the world. Everyone sees the dark, but you see the light. Everyone is groping around, getting injured, and trying to figure out how to survive. And you are already just hovering through it all. And God has your back because it is light to you. Now, it goes beyond that. Look at in Isaiah 49, verse 13. God says, listen to this. Shout for joy, you heavens. Rejoice, you earth. Burst into song, you mountains. For the Lord comforts his people and will have compassion on his afflicted ones. Now, we read a text like this and we immediately think, shout for joy, you heavens. You're thinking of the Pleiades and Orion. You're thinking of the Milky Way, the galaxy, the universe. Do you think really that's what he's talking about? That these balls of light, these planets hovering around in the universe, is shouting for joy? No. He's talking about other created worlds, other created beings, the angels. He's saying, all of the universe, all heavens, all angels, all created universes that I created shout. Okay, why? Now look at what it says. Rejoice you on the earth. Okay, rejoice you earth. Does that literally mean like the rocks, the stones are going to like, you know, rejoice and the trees are going to like move their leaves and rejoice? No, they're talking about people that live on the planet. Okay, everyone that can rejoice, rejoice. And that might even mean animals, okay? Because I know that animals have intelligence and God has used animals to even speak to us. So all of creation, you earth, rejoice. Burst into song, you mountains. The mountains singing, does that mean that the White Tank Mountains and Camelback Mountains and the Rocky Mountains and the Appalachian Mountains and the Himalayan Mountains are going to sing? No, something is unique about the mountains. God's dwelling is in the high mountains. You know, in Israel, in Mount Hermon, they believe that that is the landing place for the angels. When Jacob saw the ladder go up and down to heaven, it was on the mountain. Okay, so whenever we refer to mountains in the Old Testament, it means it is the connection nexus point. It's like the gateway between earth and heaven. Okay, so basically what God is saying is, all of the universe, all of the earth, everything that was created in them, even the angels, any access points between whatever in the mountains, okay, rejoice and burst into song. Why? Because look what it says here. Of all the things that we can say about God, the one thing God wants you to know is that the Lord will comfort his people. Now, who is his people? You know, right away you read this and you think, oh, that must be the Jews or the Israelites because it was written for them. No, not at all. This is not a message for the Jews or the Israelites. Oh, well, maybe it was for the Samaritans and the Gentiles, the people in the Middle East. Do you think that's what that means? No. The Lord comforts his people, which means that there's going to be people in the Catholic Church, in the Muslim faith, in the Hindu, the Buddhist, the Seventh-day Adventist, the Christian, the Catholic world. God has his people all over the planet, and God judges by their heart, not by what they call themselves. So here's the thing. This verse is saying that all of the universe is watching. They're going to burst out in joy because God has come in defense for his people. So don't be surprised if you find people being protected in the last days and you think that they should be destroyed. Just worry about your own relationship with God. For the Lord comforts his people and he will have compassion. How little of compassion do we have today? We think that we have it all. How about everyone else? God will bring comfort and compassion on all of his afflicted ones. Now, how that compassion comes, we don't know. I can't judge God. And many times we ask questions like, why did God allow that person to die? Why did God allow all those children to die last night? 10,000 kids died last night. I can't question God. But I do know this, those people are at least resting and they don't have to suffer the pains of this sinful world anymore. And God in his goodness will find a way to save everybody if he can. But everyone has to make a choice. So your choice today is, do you serve God or do you not serve God? If you serve God, you're going to be the receiver of God's compassion and God will stand for you, particularly during the dark hours. When the storm clouds are about to overcome you, you don't have to worry and run. You can just look up and you can say, all right, it's coming. Let me take some shelter, but God has my back. All right? And you don't have to be a Seventh-day Adventist Christian to receive this promise. This is a promise to all of humanity. Okay? Now, let's take a look at the next one, my third one this morning. Psalm 55, verse 22. Now, you know this text, but I want to break it down in a different way. You've all heard the song, Cast Your Cares on the Lord, and He, because He cares for you. Okay, think about the cares that you have in your life right now. Typically, when we think about our cares, we're thinking about our bills that we have to pay. We have to get groceries, you know, because some of us aren't working and we've been hit very hard by this pandemic. We don't know how we're going to pay rent next month. Some of us who lost jobs are trying to find medical insurance. And, you know, there's all these cares. But look at what God says. He says, you can take all of those cares and you can cast them to the Lord. Cast them on the Lord and he will sustain you. Now, he doesn't say hand them over. He doesn't say package them nicely, okay, and present them in a prayer and put them in a nice orderly list. No, he says cast them. That's like taking something and you're throwing it, okay? He says, as soon as you receive it, don't even hold on to it. Throw it right to God, and God will take care of it for you. Now, there might be something God will tell you that you have to do, okay, so that way he can move the chess pieces. So that doesn't mean just take your thing and throw it and then say, okay, I'm done. You still might have to make a phone call. You might have to fill out a form. You might still have to ask people to pray, okay? But you can take your cares and give it to the Lord and not be so consumed by it. Now look at how he finishes it. He says, God or he will never let the righteous be shaken. Okay, you know, there's a lot of times where we're shaken, but God won't allow you to be shaken to the point where you're going to be shaken out of the kingdom. So if you're going through a lot of trials, praise God for that, because God knows that you can handle it, and God is allowing it to happen because one of two things is happening in that trial. One, he's either refining something in your character or in your situation that needs to be corrected, and he's doing it out of love, and he won't allow it to happen if he doesn't have an answer at the back end of that, which means that there's a bigger blessing that's waiting for you. Or the second thing is, you're going through trials because of someone else, okay? In other words, as an example, so that way God can show his intervention in your life, and you could be the model for someone else, okay? But in all cases, you need to be focused on God, and you need to have faith and not doubt God. Because here's the thing, God's not going to allow anything to happen to you that will shake you out of eternal life. He will never let the righteous be shaken. All right, now, can you be shaken? Of course you can be shaken. I'm constantly being shaken, okay? But is it going to shake me out of a relationship with God? No, basically my shaking is massaging me. Shake me a little to the left. Get my back a little bit. You want to get under my chin? That's fine. Okay, you can shake me all you want, but I'm going to cling to the Lord. You get my point? So cast your cares to the Lord. Don't let yourself be shaken. God won't allow it to happen. Just have faith in him. All right, let's take a look at Romans chapter 8. Here's another one to mark in your Bible. Romans 8 verse 37 through 39. Now I'm going to give you all three of these. I could take every one of these, and each one has a message, but I like all three. So take a look at this. That this is a Christian soldier. It's metaphorical. He's wearing the helmet of salvation. He's a warrior in this horrible planet that we have to deal with sin. He has the sword of truth, and he's on his knees, okay? You don't ever go into battle on your own unless you're going forward with the Lord, okay? So look at what it says. No, in all these things, we are conquerors? No, we are more than conquerors. Not only did you already gain victory, but you're more than a conqueror. You've already reaped everything that you need to reap, okay? Through him who loved us. So is it you who did it? No. You're a conqueror because of what God has already done for you. No, in all these things, what things is he talking about? All your trials. In all your dark hours, know that you're already more than a conqueror through God who loved you. Because God loved you, you think God is going to allow you to go through something that's going to destroy you? No, of course not. Okay, you're already a conqueror, and he wants you to know that ahead of time. So why be fearful? If you already know you're going to win a battle, like if you're going into a boxing match, okay, back in the day, when I was young, my dad, you know, he did martial arts, and we used to watch Muhammad Ali, okay? We used to watch him fight, and it was almost a foregone conclusion that Muhammad Ali was going to win, okay? What was really cool was when it looked like he was going to lose, okay? But then he still won, okay? Imagine the confidence that he had, where he can mouth off, I am the greatest, you know, blah, 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 and he can even name the round that he was going to take down his person. You know, even Michael Jordan, he knew what he was going to win every single game. When you're that good and you know you're going to be a conqueror, you have this confidence that keeps bringing victory. Well, in the spiritual world, guess what? You already know that you're a conqueror. So that should give you confidence to know that you can fight these battles, that you can handle the dark hours. But take a look at verse 38. I am convinced. So I guess that's the question for you and I. Are we convinced? For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angel nor demon, neither present nor future, nor any power. Now, think about all the things that can actually bring fear in your life. Anything that can harm you in life. Okay, think about what is the one thing that you fear the most? Spiders, encountering a demon, Satan, maybe walking at night and some horrific apparition, a ghost shows up at night and scares the living daylights out of you. You know, maybe the IRS knocking on your door to take you to prison, or maybe they're going to foreclose on your home. Okay, look at this. Not even death. Are you fearful of death? Okay, you're afraid of pain and anxiety of dying. You're not sure. Okay, look at what he says. Not even death or life, or an angel or a demon, or what you're dealing with in the present, or what you're going to deal with in the future, which we know is going to be bad in the future, but it's not going to come to you, right? Nor any power that exists on the planet. It could be a government agency. It could be Child Protective Services. It could be any power on the earth. But look at the conclusion in verse 39. If they're high above or they're deep below or anything else in creation, a lion, a bear, a coyote, anything that you're afraid of, okay? They can't separate you. They can't harm you. They can't take you away from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. There is nothing that can harm you as a child of God. More importantly, nothing that can take your eternal salvation away. So here's the thing. If you know that you're already a conqueror, that gives you confidence, and you know that you can stand firm and there's nothing that can bring you down, man, you've got it good. Just think about these dark hours, and it's light and you can already know what's going to happen. Do you see how God's people can confront the dark hours with confidence, with hope, with victory, knowing that God has already conquered it all? He's already gained victory, that Jesus is coming again, and there's nothing in creation that will keep you separated from God. Okay? God is coming, and you're going to be reunited with him one way or another. Just stay close to him, and you're going to make it through. Now, we're going to end off my last one. This is the 15th text, and we're going to end it with John. Okay, here's Jesus in John 16, 22 through 24, and it's in red. So here's what he says. So with you, now is your time of grief. So Jesus is saying, if you're going to grieve and experience that emotion, do it now. Okay, he's saying, if you choose to grieve, now is your time to grieve. But he says, a day's coming. It's not going to last forever, because I'm going to see you again and you're going to rejoice. Grieve now, because you're going to have nothing but joy and rejoicing in the future. And no one will take away that joy. Now, this is Jesus as God. He is speaking directly to you. He's saying, if you're going to grieve, you can grieve now, because that time is going to pass. I'm going to see you again. You're going to rejoice, and no one is going to take away that joy. Why? Because God is going to be with us. In that day, you will no longer ask me anything. What does he mean by that? Jesus, what do you mean by that? Because every day I have to ask for something to God in the name of Jesus. This is why he says, very truly I tell you, my Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. Don't go on in right before God's throne and ask God. You bring Jesus with you. In the name of Jesus, I ask this. But here's what he says. There's going to come a day when you don't have to ask me for anything, because you're going to be able to receive it on your own. He's talking about when he comes again, we get to heaven. Right now, though, he says, very truly. Now, remember, I told you, when he says very truly, that is a universal truth that is unchangeable. Now, last night, I couldn't sleep. You know, I was coughing. I wasn't feeling well. I had a fever and everything. And so I thought what I would do is go out and get some fresh air. So I went outside and I looked up into the sky. And what did I see? I saw the same stars that I have seen my whole life. The same constellations, the Big Dipper. I saw everything. And I got to thinking about this. You know, the universe is solid. There is no changes. Like in the wintertime, And you know, the early or the late fall, early winter, Orion rises exactly to time. The sun comes up exactly when we expect it to be. You know, if the universe is that predictable and that unchanging, how much so the Creator who created it all? God does not change. This is why I don't understand people who say that God changed his law. that he abolished the law. How could God, who doesn't change anything in the universe, how could he take something that was that important that he wrote with his own finger? It's ridiculous when people say that God abolished the Sabbath. How could God abolish the Sabbath? It's not even a Jewish thing. God created it at creation. So he says, this God who's unchanging, the God who keeps things moving, he's telling you that truly here's the universal truth, that if you ask God the Father anything, whatever you ask, and you do it in my name, okay, you're going to receive it. Have you actually tried that? Look at what he says in verse 24. You know, up until now, you haven't even asked anything in my name. This is the problem with believers in the last days. They don't even pray. They don't even pray in Jesus' name, asking God the Father. So he's telling you right now, if you're going to confront the darkest hours, make sure you get on your knees and make sure you start praying in the name of Jesus. Now, I have a little joke going on with Sister Grace. She's my prayer ministry's leader. And with all the prayer requests that you all have been sending me, I actually take it very serious. And as soon as I receive it, I get on my knees and I pray. And I told Sister Grace this week, because she found out I was sick and I wasn't feeling that well. I said, pray for me too. And I said, you know what? With all these prayer requests, I'm going to have to get some knee pads. And she said, can you get me some too? But your prayers have been answered. I know, Sister Antoinette, Sister Charlene and Jeremy, and the list goes on, okay? Sister Leticia, all of you who have been asking for prayer who are online right now, we've been praying diligent for you. And I know that you've been praying for me. I think this is why I can preach right now, okay? Here's the thing. When you pray in the name of Jesus, God will come through for you. And I believe it. I believe God is going to come through for my family, okay? I've seen horrible things happen with COVID-19, but I know that God is only making my family immune for some reason, okay? And here's what he concludes. Ask and you will receive, okay? He doesn't say you might receive. He says you will absolutely receive it. But you have to believe it, okay? Because oftentimes we ask and we keep asking and asking and asking like we don't even believe like God is hearing our prayers. How many of you feel that? Like you pray and it only goes up to your ceiling. Guess what? Your prayer might take only up to the ceiling, but the Holy Spirit then grabs that prayer, and Jesus grabs that prayer, and he brings it directly into the throne room of God. So where your weakness fails, God's strength will prevail. Okay? Man, that even sounds good. It sounds like a song. Where your strength fails, God's strength prevails. Okay? Ask, and you will receive, and your joy will be complete. Friends, you know, in spite of who we are, God still gives us this message. You remember, he gave you these promises even before we accepted him as the Savior, before we accepted him as God. He gave you these promises in spite of who we are. And so, here's the question. Are you going to be ready for this awesome supernatural event? Because I know right now you've visualized it, we've talked about it, but if this is going to happen in your lifetime, you need to start expanding your mind and be ready for some pretty amazing sights that your eyes have never seen before. And you have to be ready to receive this scene. Now, it's an artist's rendition, but you might be one of these people in the hills watching Jesus come as the cities burn, okay? You might see all this, the dark hours around about you, but know that there's light at the end of the tunnel, and know that that promise was given to you in spite of who we are. In spite of the fact that we keep wandering away from God, God keeps reminding us, look to him, have faith, have hope, because there is a promise of a future for each of you if you believe it. I'm going to have Sister Jackie sing a song, and as she's singing, I'm going to ask each of you to rededicate your life and say, Lord, I want to be ready for that second coming. In spite of those dark hours, Lord, I want to have faith. I don't want to doubt, and I will ask in your name, and I believe that I will receive it in your name. Amen.
I felt you knocking, but I drew further from you every day. I knew better, still my heart grew colder, and I just kept on going my own way. But after all was said and done with me, after all my pride, then my fall, I was so amazed to still find you there after all I've done. You still loved me after all. Your eyes said welcome, your arms were open. How could I ever doubt your love was real? You never mentioned all my past rejections. Words can't express the way that makes me feel. And after all was said and done with me, after all my pride, then my fall, I was so amazed to still find you there after all I've done. You still loved me after all. To freely forgive is so hard to do, but you completely forgave. Now I will spend my whole life with you. After all, forever and always. After all was said and done with me, after all my pride, then my fall, I was so amazed to still find you. You still loved me after all.
Amen. After all, God still loves us. Amen. Thank you, Sister Jackie, for singing that. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we just want to thank you for these promises that you've given us in your scripture. It's as if you're standing right before us and you're giving us these messages of hope. And when they were being written by the author so many, many centuries ago, it was as if they were writing it for us, this last generation. So Lord, we take these messages of hope and we file them away that we might be able to pull them out as messages of hope and truth during these dark times. Father, I pray for everyone who's listening to this message. I pray that we can continue to cling not only to you, but cling to each other as we approach these troubling times. And Father, we ask at this moment that you will bring sustaining power, faith, healing, whatever we need, and we ask in Jesus' name all these things. And so in his name we pray this. Amen. All right, everyone. Well, have a blessed Sabbath day today. Sabbath is not even close to being over, so take some time out with your families and take time to study the Word. Take all these texts that I gave you, mark them in your Bible. That would be a fun little thing to do. I actually use different colored highlight pens right here that I do on my Bible, so make it fun for yourself. But most importantly, find the application. When you read each one, here's the challenge. Take each text and break it down and then stop on each one and then just close your eyes and say, what happened in my life in the past? What's happening in my life right now where this could be true, where I can apply it right now? You see, that's where you get the power of the text, the power of the Holy Spirit. You know, the Holy Spirit can do a lot there. When you add your experiences and your trials and you combine it with the Holy Spirit, with the Word of God, your will is now combining with the will of God, and that's when you see omnipotence. Okay, so I'm curious to hear your testimonies. Reach out to me, text me, email me. Let me know if you want to give a little testimony, read a scripture, or how this series has impacted you. But until we see each other next time, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face to shine upon you. May the Lord lift up His countenance upon you and all your family. In the name of Jesus, we ask this. Amen. God bless everyone, and Shabbat Shalom.